Well, I think we'll call our meeting to order. So, ask Mr. Treasurer to call our roll, please.
Okay, Mr. Cole?
Here.
Ms. Rannan?
Hello, yes.
Ms. Hudson?
Here.
Mr. Johnson? Mr. Robinson? Mr. Peretti?
Here.
Mr. Stewart? You have four members, so you have a quorum.
And we did hear from Tim and Reggie that they were not able to join us today, so. So thank you. With that, we have a short agenda today. We'll be looking at the revised and the most recent version of the five-year forecast and our FY17 budget that we would be looking at, would be sending for the board to consider for the fiscal year, or beginning of the new fiscal year. So I'll turn it over to Stan and Scott.
Certainly. Hopefully we will share in this presentation. What I have, you have two packets and then a single page before you. The one packet is the answer to the questions from the last meeting. To the extent you would like to talk about those, I'd be glad to do that. I sent, I think, a couple of updates along the way as I got some answers to it. I would say this, if you would, and this is the page that's marked 4/14/16 FAC meeting follow-up. If you turn to page 2, this is something that Chair Hudson has been asking me for, admittedly, way too long. I finally got the data and put it all together. This is a tabulation of the abatements that are on the books. I got this from the Franklin County Auditor's Office. Marked them all with the year that they come off abatement and come back on the tax rolls by the dollar amount of the estimated tax that has been foregone. So it's all an estimate at this point, but it gives you an idea of the magnitude of these dollar amounts over time. I think it was Member Robinson that pointed out, if nothing else, at least we addressed that question as to how large is this abatement issue. And as you can mm-hmm. see, from 2017 to 2029, some 18 years, it's about $17 million over that span. Abatements and them coming back on the duplicate have always been in our forecast. They show up in new construction, and we calculate rates based upon that in the forecast. It's, again, another sausage-making process. But they are in there. We predict usually about 2% new construction coming online. So they have been factored in. I'm proposing that I would include this, mm-hmm. maybe not as a line in the forecast, but in the notes to it.
Yes.
Because that forecast layout is very particular to what the state requires. So I will include this tabulation in some form in the notes to the forecast, so that at least we demonstrate we've looked at it.
I think that's great. And mm-hmm. I think it also keeps it out there for community discussion, you know, on a go forward basis, as some of that might, you know, could increase.
Okay.
That's great.
So that was probably the main item I thought that I'd call mm-hmm. attention to in there. Moving on to the forecast, this is one that's got a big draft stamp on it on the front. That's the first page is the actual forecast format, and the totals will align to what you see then on page 3, which has been our discussion format of the budget preparation process, which overlays this forecast process. In addition to this page, behind it are the changes that we've made up to this point. In payroll, the only thing that was added since last we met were some minor tweakings to the payroll cost in 18, 19, and 20. When we actually got into the calculation we used in the forecast document, there was some minor modification. As you can see, $83,000, $48,000, $131,000, not large dollar items there, just to tweak those numbers. And again, remember, this forecast and the upcoming FY17 budget on payroll, on FTEs, only includes the essential FTEs for fiscal 17. Mm-hmm. Nothing new on the purchase services chart or supplies and materials. Again, those all delineate what we've taken out for capital funding. Nothing new on capital outlay, but I wanted you all to have that once again. So since we last met, not much in the way of changes have been done, very, very minimal. And so I would submit this to you as what we would recommend, and I'm prepared to recommend to the board at the next board meeting, and to the president and vice president of the board. My apologies. It just simply got busy. I didn't put the five-year forecast on the board agenda review today, but I will have that to put out there on next Tuesday. That's our first hearing. I got back to my office and went, oops, sorry, forgot that. We've been doing so much of it here, it's as if I've already had all those hearings. So, but we will present it officially for the first time to the board. And it will look like this.
Okay. That's good. That's good. Does anyone have any questions or comments about where we are so far? I mean, I feel like we've had a very good, thorough discussion on mm-hmm. this, certainly. And, well, we, you know, we can continue. There will be, I know, additional discussion on budget in addition to the placeholder, but that'll be our, well, I thought today is just about the placeholder budget and this forecast. So so then we'll breathe, and then we'll tomorrow begin that part too, and as well. Very good. So at this point, do we need to adopt this or just recommend this go forward? Or just anybody have any objections?
I think you would recommend for this to be presented to the board formally.
Okay, very good.
So maybe a motion.
So a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Oh, hold second. On 1 second.
All right, sorry, I'm late.
Oh, you're good.
Sit down, sir.
Wherever you like.
Brian.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
That's good.
That's good. So, Brian, we'll
switch the name plates there first.
That's a hell.
The record there.
Okay,
there we go.
So the treasurer has, if there's a document behind your agenda, and it says draft on it at the top, it's a financial statement. If you flip a couple pages in, five-year forecast and budget reflecting no new revenue. So it's, I don't think it's changed. No, there haven't been any significant changes since our last meeting.
Just one statement sent to us.
Okay. Yes. Yes. It does reflect the various days of operating capital that are remaining. There's a separate sheet that has kind of follow-ups to our questions. Want to take a look at that before. So what we're just considering is, you know, if this is in shape enough, in a good enough shape to go to the board. I should say, if we feel like this is appropriate to go to the board. So I think we were entertaining a motion to that effect.
And there was a motion and a second for me.
Okay. So before we vote on that, Brian, I know we're putting you on the spot, but just wondering if there's anything you want to cover or have questions about.
Just a couple of questions, and you probably answered this.
No, that's fine.
Quickly. It was all other financing sources, 2.060. Notice that there was a change of 783%, if I'm reading that correctly. I'm just curious to get a little bit more insight into that.
That's a big bump.
That is.
That's a three-year average change from 136,000 to 2.48. Is that what you're referencing?
That is. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And that should be.
Isn't that workers' comp?
Oh, that's correct. Thank you.
Or no, the treasurer's.
The treasurer's refund. The treasurer's refund of it was like 2.48. Almost the entire amount, about 2.2 million. Remember that back in 15? About 2.2 million that they refunded or rebated to us?
Yes, I do.
That would show up on that line.
Okay.
And it came out of the...
So that was a one-time adjustment?
Yes. They have that real estate fund that they use for a variety of delinquent advertisements and then collection of receipts. When that builds up to a certain point, they decide to rebate that back.
Okay.
One, Paul.
Okay.
And this forecast, right, the forecast we have right now, it, does it include the win-win?
It assumes win-win continues, yes.
Assumes win-win continues. Okay. So as we have updates on that, we can also address that. Brian, did you have other?
I did. That was the one that got my attention.
Good. Oh, and just as the treasurer pointed out on the this FAC meeting follow-up, it's a separate page. He did provide the analysis. Go to page two. He did provide the analysis, the analysis of the real estate tax abatements and when they burn off.
Okay. Thank you.
So he's going to include those as a footnote to capital improvements. Is that for capital?
No, to the, just to the notes to the forecast. And they have, where they show up is in our overall calculation, down in the guts of that calculation. We do an estimate for new construction, and that's where these would roll into. And since we factor in about a 2% new construction every year to come on, we've accounted for it in there. We don't do it specifically because we don't really get that information. Hey, this has come back online, but it does show up as new construction. So it's been accounted for over time. So this isn't like new revenue, but because it was an issue and a question of what's the impact of the abatements over time, at least if we detail it here in the notes, we'll have a feeling for the magnitude of that. But it has been factored in.
Do we get notices if they're gonna, if the abatement's going to be extended, or if it's proposed to be extended?
That I don't know. I know a lot of the conversation about
that
goes on at what's that committee called? TURC, Tax Incentive Review.
Tax Review Council, TOC.
They go over all of this to see if they're living up to their commitments. Mm-hmm. And if there are any revisions, I'm sure we come up with that council, which we have a member on that.
Are they normally like 5 or 10 year? The bumps are kind of interesting. And then in 2028, there's this, you know, 2 million again. I was curious how, like, are they 20 year abatements? Well, yeah, but I didn't know if it
it's project by project, like 10 years, 15 years.
Okay.
They vary.
Okay. Well, we should, we'll parking lot that for another discussion, so.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have a motion on the floor. Any further comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Okay. So we'll forward this on to the board.
And I believe one other follow-up item, this is going to be Mr. Goodings and Dr. Good's area. One of the follow-ups was in the fiscal 17 budget and in this forecast, we have only the desired requested FTE for fiscal 17. And the question was, what's it look like in your overall aspirational budget out into 18 through 21? And there's a single sheet that you have that breaks that down for you. And I'll turn that over to Scott.
Because with the five-year forecast, the board's approving all 5 years. But on the budget process, remember the board's only going to approve FY17 as part of the annual appropriation resolution. Mm-hmm. So you'll have that includes the 39.5. Years fiscal year 18 through 21 or more for planning purposes, the placeholders will have. Dr. Good and staff, we've worked very hard, for almost a year now, working on identifying metrics on how we should staff certain positions at levels based on data and research. So we've done that, and these are the FTEs that we're bringing forward by specific categories. So school psychologists, guidance counselors, social workers, instructional assistants for priority schools, English as a second language. You see them all spelled out there, so we're itemizing them by program, by year, and with the corresponding FTE on those. Obviously, as we move forward and get into looking at the FY18 budget, these won't you won't see these exact each year because there may be a change throughout the year. We may need to adjust some. We may need to react to pending legislation that's out there. Dan, what was the one that just came out looking at?
House Bill 64.
Looking at the psychologists, social workers, things like that, that we may have to react to. So we may have to move things around in here to accommodate the legislation. So this is what we're putting forward. Obviously, looking at the five-year forecast, we're only projecting a balance through 18. So obviously, we know we can't hire any of these folks until there's sufficient funding to do so. So we're looking at these in those last 4 years for planning purposes.
Yes.
So for the 18 FTEs, would we be looking at those possibilities being reflected then in the May 17 cyber forecast? If it comes online, we can see the impact?
Yes. So
it's really not that far off.
Mm-hmm. Right. Or, I mean, at any time the board, I'll start, you can jump in on this one if you
sure.
want to do something different. The board can approve, you know, you have to approve a forecast in October and then your update in May. But if there were things that would change from a revenue or expense side, you could adopt a new forecast at any time. So if we wanted to do something within that time frame, the board obviously has that right to do so.
Mm-hmm.
And things change significantly.
Yeah, go please.
Maybe for Dr. Good, would you maybe just be able to sort of maybe walk mm-hmm. through some of the 18's allocations and what you see?
I can.
How that sort of reflects our need.
We did. So really we looked at 2021 because the expectation was we look at the five-year plan, understanding that we couldn't do everything at the beginning. So if you start with the first column to the right of the descriptions, 2017 reflects those we felt were essential in order to operate the district mm-hmm. at its current levels for next year. The only new item in there really is their learning center. So you'll see a director, a supervisor there, a secretary, a custodian, et cetera, for the Early Learning Center 2017. So I wouldn't even look at that column. Those are things that we would be able to do if we stay within our means, our current means. So starting with FY18 through FY21, we kind of took a look at what that far right column is and then backed into those other years, understanding that in some situations like early childhood education, which is about midway down the page, we're not going to be able to add 20 classrooms in 1 year. 5 classrooms is what we believed we had capacity to add each year, because each classroom also implicates instructional assistance, because you have to have a certain, by contract, we have to have instructional assistance with our early childhood education professionals. So that's how we did that one. If you look up at right underneath academic services, Scott was referring to House Bill 64, which is truancy legislation, seems to be moving forward. We still haven't seen the House version of what, or the Senate version of what they're going to introduce, but we still believe ultimately what is right is that there will be a multidisciplinary team. The districts are required to convene to address students' needs when a student misses 10 or more days of school. Mm-hmm. So if they're chronically absent, whether those 10 days were excused or unexcused, they're considered chronically absent. A multidisciplinary team would need to be comprised, and that team is comprised of social workers, licensed school nurses, counselors, teachers, but also other stakeholders, other providers in the community, such as Metropolitan Housing Authority, the Department of Health, the food banks that are local, so that in this legislation, it's believed that we need to reach in and lift the family up in order to help address those truancy issues. So it's a solid piece of legislation from a principal perspective. Obviously, it would be another unfunded mandate, which we're quite accustomed to, but we build into here those sorts of positions that would accommodate that multidisciplinary team from the district's perspective in anticipation. It probably, in some form, it will bear out that we have to add those social service professionals. So you can see those, and we ramp that up. We talked about licensed school nurses. That's another person who would be on that team. And so we've added 15 in that first year and then 8 each year thereafter, which would take us to the equivalent of 1 full-time licensed school nurse per building, but that's not the way they would be deployed. You're familiar with Colerain, which is a medically fragile site, kids on G-tubes, kids on ventilators. You have to have extra licensed school nurses present and the way that Kate built her metrics, Scott talked about the metrics document, it's very clear. These are high incidence needs, these are moderate incidence needs, these are low incidence needs, and that's then the way we determine how we deploy those resources. For the counselors and social workers, we already have counselors, so 40 additional over those four or five years would take us up to the equivalent of one counselor per, I think, I don't remember the exact number of students, but it's based upon students and social workers as well. We only have 23 social workers right now, which is why you see a large number there ultimately for social workers. We know, and again, I know you've heard me say it before, we really need to shift our focus from treating the student as the unit of change to treating the family as the unit that needs our support, and so social workers are well equipped to help us with that. Instructional assistance, that you go right below social workers, you see two columns there. You go to the second one, you see we've added 58 instructional assistants. So in our priority schools, and we have, in our priority schools, versus reducing class size and coming up with new facility space and adding additional teachers, which we budgeted around $85,000 per teacher, is that correct? Yeah, with benefits and salary. We talked with our staff, and the additional set of hands could appear in the form of an instructional assistant. So you could further differentiate with that additional paraprofessional in the classroom. And the 58, the 34 initially in 2018 represents one instructional assistant for every two teachers. So you would have that additional support half the day in the primary grades. The following year, which is the 24, represents adding those instructional assistants in the intermediate. So in grades 4, 5, and 6 then, each teacher has a half-time aide in their classroom. Again, breaking down the ratio of students to teachers, allowing for more differentiation, small group instruction. So that addresses a significant need. It's also in anticipation of what may be required in the ESSA, or the Elementary and Secondary School Reauthorization, at the federal level. So we know that there will be some sanctioning there about what kinds of adult provisions will need to be present in those priority settings. We continue to anticipate new Americans in the immigrant category. We just used our data from the past, our trend data, anticipate we'll need 6 additional ESL professionals and classified support in those lines. Special ed, we did the same. It was interesting. We kind of eyeballed and said, I think we ought to anticipate about 15 when we actually, when Kathy produced the actual trend data, we were on the money on that. We're pretty close to on the money on that one. So the 15 additional one, that's another one. Depending on the type of classroom, whether it's MD, ED, CD, what have you, it may also implicate the OPSI contract, meaning we would have to provide instructional assistance at some level for those professional teachers. Then, with the exception of the internal audit down there, and internal auditor's addition there, which is close to the bottom, and the gifted and talented and career tech, which are all the way at the bottom, the others are for the business and operations side of the organization. Mm-hmm. And what we're working toward is getting closer to industry standards, how many acres a landscape professionals maintain, and we get a lot of that from College and University magazine and the studies they've conducted. So it's nowhere near to what the industry standards are. We would be adding hundreds of classified employees in order to actually meet those standards. The reality is that not many organizations truly do achieve those standards. It's just like the counselor standard is 250 students per counselor. So we exceed that significantly, as do most districts. And really, honestly, it ought to be based on need. What Maurice will tell you is to clean a room like this that is not carpeted, you can do that much more quickly than a room that's carpeted. It requires a vacuum versus an automated buffer and polisher. So it's those minutiae that implicate the metrics that Scott's group has comprised in a pretty healthy document that helped us to determine each of these. So we did put a bunch more in there for career tech, 16 total over the next 5 years. Mm-hmm. Reason being, I think we can all accurately predict that this will be the new pathway to prosperity for our students, pathways to careers. Career tech isn't our old wood shop and home ec anymore. Right. We're introducing cybersecurity, so the downtown high school. So these are very relevant, application-based, real problem-solving ways for students to learn versus the traditional teacher in the front of the classroom standing behind a podium and lecturing, which doesn't work for millennials, probably doesn't work for many of us anymore. Most people have these, or if they don't, you'll notice that in the non-personnel budget, we had allocated or budgeted for additional mobile devices, Chromebooks, what have you, for a correspondence of 2-to-1. So for every 2 students, there would be actually 1 mobile device, and really moving into that blended learning environment. Mm-hmm. Vice President Coles talked about that before, the benefits of allowing students to have that independence, but at the same time have a learning coach that can, they can process what they're viewing and help them make sense of it and help them apply it in very relevant ways. But career tech, I will definitely see an expansion, and that was part of the governor's state of the state address, so we know that they'll continue to invest in those areas. Does that kind of help? So we also, so when you look at the second page.
Wait. Hold on before we turn to the agenda. Carolyn wanted to comment.
I just want to speak to the internal audit request. Last year, there were two planned FTEs to join the Office of Internal Audit, but through looking at the needs of the organization, one of those positions went to the
Legal Services.
Compliance office, and then one came to internal audit. So the looking at the risk assessment, you know, the risk is still there. We are doing our best to provide adequate coverage with the staffing that we have, but I still feel and probably, well, and confident I can demonstrate the need for this additional person to come on board in 2018.
Sure. And certainly with the risks identified on, especially on IT-related issues, and as we continue to grow in that area, I think every enterprise will be challenged along those lines.
I did have a question around transportation. I was noticing that there are just a couple of increases in FY 2017 and 18, but didn't see any subsequent.
These were a good question. These were for dispatchers, these for additional dispatching services. We talked to Maurice. They projected they would really like to have three in this first year. And just as we did with every budget manager, we went back and said, what is it you absolutely have to have if we don't have additional revenue to support our budget requests? And from Steve Simmons and Jeff Frabel that oversee transportation and Kernan Bussey, they said they could get by with one this next year, but they were still in the aspirational budget. They would like us to include two to break down the number of routes per dispatcher that are monitored and supported. Is that accurate, Scott? Because I really just made all that up. No, I'm kidding. No, it's true. So.
And you were going to go to the next page.
Well,
next
yeah, page. Is so the next one three. There?
We only have one page.
No, I meant the.
Oh, this, okay.
Yes. Here. Is the second one there? Spam or?
Payroll?
Not payroll. The one with the.
Oh, it no. Was not printed to hand out. I
okay, I'm
have
sorry.
It if you'd like me to.
No, not necessarily. So we did build it in to take a look at what how it would impact the five-year forecast so that we understood kind of what we're looking at in terms of cash balance into 2021 and recognize, and we've already gone back to our budget managers. I thought we need to start that, but Scott's already started that process and said, okay, if you don't get all of this, you know, again, what do you feel you must have in 2018? What do you feel you must have? So it's kind of back to your, if you don't get the Cadillac, and you want to do a little better than the Prius, what's in between there? Is there a Tesla that we could look at or something that might get us closer to those aspirations, but also be respective to what our community may or may not support in terms of additional revenue?
Sure. And if I understand it, also with the facilities review committee process going on, that will also probably identify some surplus properties that if we needed to address some of the items we got labeled for bond, that could be offset as if we had identified items that could be sold and then applied there too.
So, I mean, it's a very timely conversation, interesting, because some of the board colleagues and I had that conversation earlier today, in fact, about looking at what property, what real estate may exist and whether it's something the board as a whole might entertain liquidating. And what allowances would we have with the proceeds from the sale of properties? There are restrictions on that, we do know that. And so it probably could fund some capital items, but we don't know whether it's restricted to only facilities or whether it could in fact offset textbook requests, technology okay. requests, and so on. That's really a question for.
I think as you're crunching that, I think that would be just good to, you know, again, the turn over every rock in this process. If to the extent we can do that, then that'll provide the board with as many alternatives as possible.
We I mean it's in, you know that is why we engaged on this facility master plan project and have the ad hoc committee to look at all of the board's real estate. The focus up to this point has just been on schools, keeping in mind that we have a camp. We're sitting in a building that doesn't house children presently. So we need to look at those as well. And I believe that's the next phase. The Dr. Stanford is championing with Tracy Richter, that there'll be, and Alex is involved in that. So they're looking at those other pieces of real estate and, you know, the utility they may offer to the district. So the district has that whole, you know, it's all laid out before them, and then the board can, we can make some recommendations, the board can respond to those.
Good. And then that'll be, I think.
Did you want to buy this building, maybe?
No, no.
We're open for bids right now.
I think that by the, you know, maybe you could let us know when we, not the facility so much, but just this information, when, you know, if that'll be available for our next meeting.
Probably won't for the next meeting. I don't have a timeline for the FM.
Not the non-capital items.
Okay.
The non-capital.
Yes, we'll have that for the next.
Yes.
Where we back out things that we said, okay, this one isn't essential.
Just as a reminder, you know that when we started with our aspirational non-personnel budget, we did back out quite a bit of capital.
Mm-hmm.
To the tune of right now, $153.3 million, spread out from fiscal 17 to fiscal 21. And it, you know, that's going to factor, you know, you've got several things going on where we're identifying capital needs. So you've got FMP, you've got what we pulled out here. So we have plenty of places to find funding for, but $153.3 million has been pulled out of that aspirational request already.
Right.
So what I believe our charge is now, is what we're working on, is looking at the non-capital, aspirational, non-personnel items, and what must remain in, and what can be pulled out and maybe reallocated for personnel if we are to live within our needs. And then also to create some simulations for those years out, if we do generate new revenue, what could we do that isn't necessarily the Cadillac, but maybe in a couple of different phases there. So we'll be able to do that. The other piece I think I heard you asking was understanding, once the ad hoc committee completes their work and the board reacts to the recommendations relative to facility master plans, is understanding maybe some value of the real estate and whether in fact that's a conversation the board wants to have about maybe flipping those properties and offsetting some of the maybe the essential capital needs that are in the budget that are eligible for facilities, building fund sales. Is that what it is? Yeah, building sales.
Sale of building funds.
Sale of building funds. I do think the words right. It's in the wrong order. Or whether in fact those could be used to offset some of the capital items that were pulled out in order to potentially lower a bond levy request. So.
Yes. So we reconvene May 12th. So that'll be the next stop on this journey. So we'll review the five-year forecast with the board May 3rd, and then May 12th, FAC will have this next go-round of this analysis. Good. I think that's a good recap. Anybody have any other comments to that?
No, I'm just excited about the, about the investment, particularly in what I would think would be socio-emotional with the social workers and some of these other areas where we're looking really progressively at addressing issues that impact the quality of education in the district. So thank you for thinking that out. I like the strategy and how you did that in terms of looking from 21 back and saying, what is it that we need? And how can we evenly make these types of appropriations in a way that keep us at scale? So
yes,
thank you.
You're welcome.
Good. Okay, well with that, I think, do we have anything else to come before the committee today?
I have nothing to add. What a shock, huh?
Whoa. So we'll entertain a motion to adjourn. All in favor, let's adjourn. Thank you. Bye.